Hey, 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 it's LabPadre. Welcome back, and thanks for tuning in to episode 29 of our SpaceX and Starbase weekly updates. We have a ton of information for you to digest today, so let's dig in. Starting off this week, early Friday morning, Ship 27's common dome was moved into Star Factory as the new building now appears usable while construction wraps up. Around dawn at Launch Complex 39A, the ninth and final module of the Starship launch tower was lifted into place, topping out the structural steel of SpaceX's second Mechazilla. A few hours later, back at Starbase, the B7.1 test tank was relocated to the Sanchez site following its latest round of testing. A short time later, the chopsticks were raised partway up the tower in preparation for another day of booster testing. As the tank farm was spinning up for the day, Booster 7's grid fins underwent some testing as they were rotated back and forth. As SpaceX began chilling down at Stage Zero, venting was seen from a new location on the orbital launch mount. A few hours later, we saw yet another spin prime test from Booster 7, this time with 7 Raptor engines spinning up in a staggered start. Meanwhile, Raptor Roost caught a wild deer in the wildlife refuge that surrounds SpaceX's Starbase facilities in Texas. With booster testing finished for the day, the chopsticks returned to the base of the tower. That evening, however, SpaceX had additional plans for chopsticks testing as they again traveled up the tower. Later, with the arms at the top of the tower, the red status lights and the new warning strobes were observed flashing. Saturday morning, with testing now complete, the chopsticks were once again lowered to the tower's base. At the build site, a rainbow was spotted splitting the gap between High Bay and Mega Bay. That afternoon, one of Ship 24's hatches was opened to allow workers access to the liquid oxygen tank. Sunday morning, 2 SPMTs loaded with counterweights arrived at the build site, indicating a vehicle move was planned in the near future. Sunday evening, Falcon 9 booster B1067 finally took to the skies for the Starlink 4-34 mission following 5 days of scrubs due to weather. Sunday night, the Raptor maintenance platform was lowered from the launch mount to its awaiting stand. Monday morning brought a fresh round of testing, and once everything was ready, Booster 7 again performed a staggered start spin prime test with 7 of its Raptor engines. Later, SpaceX appeared to recycle for another test, and a crowd of spectators gathered at the road. A short time later, fire once again roared from the base of Booster 7 as it performed its latest static fire. This roughly 7-second burn was confirmed in tweets from Elon and SpaceX to be a 7-engine static fire. This means that this test was the largest number of Raptors ever ignited together, beating Ship 20 and 24 6-engine tests. Following this powerful test, a small grass fire was seen near the launch site, but it quickly burned itself out. As afternoon turned to evening, Booster 8 was rolled out of Mega Bay on its 2 SPMTs. Shortly after leaving Mega Bay, Booster 8 turned out of the build site onto Highway 4. Over the next hour or so, the newest Super Heavy made its first trip to the launch site, where it will soon undergo cryogenic proof testing. In High Bay, Ship 25 was moved from the turntable to a transport stand as its stacking was finally complete. Late Monday night, Booster 7's transport stand returned to the launch site from its recent stay at Sanchez. Following Monday's static fire, one of Booster 7's central Raptors was removed in the early hours of Tuesday morning. Later that morning, one of the outer Raptor boost engines was also taken off the booster. Shortly after, a new Raptor boost was installed in its place, but no replacement was seen for the removed center Raptor. The 2 recently removed Raptors were later spotted leaving the launch pad, headed to the build site under tarps. Over at Port Canaveral, Bob towed a shortfall of Gravitas out to sea ahead of the new Starlink launch. That afternoon, the QD arm was swung away from the tower, making room for the chopsticks. Next, the chopsticks were moved up above Booster 7 before rotating to either side of the rocket and lowering into lifting position. At the build site, one of Ship 25's aft flaps was lifted into High Bay for installation on the Starship. Wednesday morning, a new cover was lifted and installed on the outside of Ship 24's payload bay door at Test Stand B. A short time later, outside low bay, a Starlink dispenser was loaded into a payload bay ring section, possibly belonging to Ship 27. Back at the launch site, the booster quick disconnect was detached from Booster 7 as SpaceX prepared to lift the booster. Once everything was prepared and the orbital pad cleared, the chopsticks picked up the Super Heavy booster and swung it over above its transport stand before lowering it. As it neared the stand, the alignment pins were extended to guide the booster in. That afternoon, Booster 9's downcomber was moved into Mega Bay for installation as construction of this updated booster continues. Once Booster 7 was secured to its transport stand, the chopsticks released the booster and the ship QD arm was swung back in. About 2 hours later, Booster 7 rolled onto the road for its latest return to the build site. Thanks to a tweet from Elon, we know that this trip back to Mega Bay is for robustness upgrades. Wednesday night, the second aft flap for Ship 25 was lifted into the high bay for integration on the vehicle. Back at the launch site, the newly installed fire suppression system was tested as the 6 water nozzles sprayed water under the launch mount. Early Thursday morning, crews continued work on the latest upgrades to the orbital launch mount, showering sparks from inside the ring. A few hours later, with workers cleared from the area, additional testing of the fire suppression system was seen from the launch mount. Throughout the day, testing continued with pressurized gas, likely nitrogen, spraying down into the water stream to help distribute it throughout the area. The E-Dome and B7.1 test tanks were moved from the Sanchez site to SpaceX's developing facilities at the former Massey's gun range location. Late in the morning, the chopsticks were lowered back to the base of the orbital launch tower. As launch mount testing continued, a long nitrogen purge occurred from the fire suppression lines and the booster quick disconnect ports. Shannon, one of SpaceX's Dragon recovery ships, left for Tampa awaiting the return of the Crew 4 mission in October. Overnight, crews were once again very busy on the orbital pad, with scaffolding and other equipment being lifted into the launch mount. Throughout the night, many new pieces of metal shielding were also lifted for the installation on the inside of the launch ring. At the tank farm, a motor for the methane pump was removed and placed on a pallet. And soon thereafter, the methane pump itself was removed and laid horizontally on another pallet located nearby. This week, we are happy to once again bring you a Cape update thanks to our flyover photos from Greg Scott and Farrielle Mohan, as well as some ground photos from LabPadre's own WLAnimal. Let's start off this week with a look at NASA's Space Launch System rocket at Launch Complex 39B. The Artemis 1 launch vehicle continues to sit at the pad awaiting its next launch opportunity. On Wednesday, NASA performed cryogenic testing on the vehicle to verify the recent repair work performed at the pad. While there were some issues with hydrogen leak during the test, NASA said that all of their objectives were met. Always safety conscious, during their cryogenic testing, a convoy of emergency vehicles was on standby, including 2 armored MRAP vehicles. Following the test, it was announced that the Space Force had granted the FTS waiver through the October 2nd launch window. With possible severe weather approaching the area, NASA has decided to stand down from the launch attempt scheduled for the 27th. Crawler Transporter 2 has been moved to the launch site and teams are preparing for a rollback, but a final decision on if the rocket will return to the VAB is expected sometime today, the 25th. Just to the southeast of SLS is SpaceX's Launch Complex 39A. This historic pad is one of 2 Florida sites that SpaceX currently launches their Falcon 9 rockets from, and is also the only site in the country that is currently able to launch people into orbit. SpaceX is also developing the site for Starship launches in the near future. As mentioned previously, the final module of the Starship orbital launch tower was stacked this week, although the 4 sheaves were removed from the module prior to its lift for unknown reasons. Also this week, 4 additional cryogenic storage tanks, bought used from a company in Canada, arrived on a barge from Brownsville, 2 of which can be seen here already at the launch site. The other 2 tanks were still sitting by the dock near the VAB. Shortly after the flyover, those were also moved to the pad. work continues on the new tank structure being built between the two launch towers. The upper half of the base looks like it's being prepared for additional concrete. The tank is still awaiting its top domes, which are being built on the ground nearby. Also being built on the back of the pad is what appears to be a large water deluge system. This large hexagon-shaped structure is made with large diameter piping and looks to have almost 200 smaller but still large diameter pipes coming off of it, which should put out a very large volume of water when used. On the north side of the launch site, SpaceX has been refurbishing the old hydrogen sphere for the Starship tank farm. Much of the work seems to have been completed, with the tank now sporting a fresh coat of paint and new labels. Over near the base of the launch tower, we can also see that SpaceX has their own long-reach boom lift, similar to the one that has been delivered to Starbase last month. A few miles to the southeast is SpaceX's Space Launch Complex 40, where the Starlink 4-34 mission launched last night before this picture was taken, and where the Starlink 4-35 mission should have launched by the time you watch this episode just 6 days later. About 5 miles to the southwest is SpaceX's Roberts Road facility. This site is split in two halves, with the east currently focused more on the Falcon 9 rockets, while the west section is for Starship. With the recent expansion of Hangar X looking complete, crews now seem to be working to finish grading on the lot to the north of the building. SpaceX seems to be using the south end of the building as a staging ground with several of their new SPMTs, as well as what looks to be the parts for multiple gantry cranes. There is also a very long SPMT that appears to be used as a Falcon 9 horizontal transporter. Just across the retention ponds from Hangar X is the Starship Launch Tower assembly area. While all of the tower modules have rolled to the pad and been stacked, there are still several parts for the tower visible in this area. The cable chain that is used to house all the power, communication, and hydraulic connections between the tower and the chopsticks is staged on the ground here. Two sheaves for the lifting cable are also visible nearby. Two spools of cables are nearby, which are likely the lifting cable for the drawworks hoist. Meanwhile, SpaceX seems to be preparing to assemble modules for another tower. Several of the module jig bases have been staged back on the concrete pads. A new set of black jig bases is also visible on the ground. Just west is the chopstick assembly area. On the ground near the white truck are the four gas spring and pistons for the catching beams awaiting installation. Next to the chopsticks is the carriage, which has had parts of the hydraulic systems installed in recent weeks. And next to the carriage is the ship quick disconnect arm, which has had its hinge section removed for unknown reasons. To the south of the chopsticks and the QD area, work is progressing rapidly on the Star Factory building. Black siding has started going up on the first section of the building. The roofers have finished its first part of the building and are now moving westward onto the next section. The steel continues to move southward, and some bridge crane rails have also been added to the newer area. The final prefabricated steel section for this latest row lies ready, and the remaining bar joists are staged nearby. The concrete slab is still moving south and slowly catching up to the foundation work. Crews are still working their way through the final two rows of column footings while also finishing up the underground conduit runs. In the final corner of the Starship area of the site, construction of the mega bay looks ready to kick into high gear. The steel for the first level of the building has been staged around the foundation and are waiting for the cranes to lift them for installation. On the south side of the building, a Buckner LR1300 crane looks almost ready to be raised for work after being laid down recently for a reconfiguration. The new Buckner in SpaceX's LR11000 stands ready for work on the north side of the building. Near the new crane, we can also see groups of concrete pads that will be used as bases to assemble the corners of the mega bay on the ground before lifting into place. Also staged in this area is the refurbished drawworks hoist that will be installed on the launch tower in the near future. A few miles south of Roberts Road are Blue Origin's Cape Canaveral production facilities. Groundwork continues in preparation for new construction to the west of the warehouse building. Steady progress is seen on the steelwork for the expansion of the south end of the warehouse. Transitioning to the north end of the site, construction is still moving forward on the New Glenn second stage cleaning and testing building. The doorway at the top of the building was opened during the flyover, letting us see the bridge crane at the top of the building. Interestingly, on Wednesday, both the upper door and the main door were both closed. Also spotted this week was what looks to be a new Glenn horizontal transporter. Let's move now to the southeast and take a look at Relativity Space's Launch Complex 16. Relativity's first Terran 1 3D printed rocket is still on the pad for testing. This first stage underwent a 57-second static fire on Wednesday. On Friday, the 9 Aeon 1 engines were fired again for 82 seconds. As Relativity Space is working their way up to a full-duration static fire ahead of their first orbital flight test, their CEO said on Saturday that they were going to roll the rocket back to the hangar as a precaution due to the possible hurricane in the area later this week. Let's wrap this week up with a quick tour of Port Canaveral. At the time of the flyover, Dragon recovery vessel Shannon and fairing recovery vessel Bob both sat at the SpaceX dock in the west turning basin awaiting their next mission. A shortfall of gravitas was also tied to the dock, and its octograbber could just be seen inside its storage room. As mentioned before, Bob and shortfall of gravitas left port on Tuesday for the Starlink 4-35 launch. On the dock adjacent to the drone ship, Falcon 9 booster B-1058 sat waiting for a transporter. B-1058 is the Falcon 9 fleet leader, having completed a record 14 launches and awaiting refurbishment ahead of its 15th. And there you have it, another SpaceX and Starbase weekly update brought to you by LabPadre. As always, a special thanks to Spaceflight Now at Cape Canaveral for providing us with quality content and updates. We'll see you next week, and thanks for watching. LabPadre out.